Hello and good afternoon and welcome to Unlocking the Power of You. This is Timothy White Sr., your host for the day and this week. And before we go into our continuing our military month, there's a few announcements that I wanted to make for some of the people who have been sponsoring us and supporting us. One of which was Tribe Brothers Tailoring. And this brother is out there and he's been doing a great job for us. And then we have John Derrick's Hair Studio, 1-2200 Fairhill Boulevard. And he's doing an awesome job. And for those of you who are in the military, I want to make this announcement. It's given to me by our veteran friend, Mr. Art Finley, who is telling us about this. So I want to let you know it's a COVID-19 vaccine eligibility. It's who to all veterans, spouses of veterans, caregivers of veterans, and the recipients. And who they are, it talks about on this certificate. So if you didn't get your shot, you need to get a shot, and I recommend that you do get the shot, and don't make an excuse and say, hey, you know what? I don't think I need to get the shot. Yes, we do. You need to get the shot, because if you're not helping you, you're helping someone else. And for those who want to find our podcast every week, you can find us on Facebook, you can find us on Twitter, you can find us on YouTube, you have us on Roku TV, Apple TV, Amazon Fire TV, every week. And with that being said, with these quick announcements, we're going to also make mention, because I feel my president telling me, did you make mention of the book that you have written, the Lynching Rope No Longer Required? This is a book dealing with the deaths of unarmed men, women, and children who were killed by the police. And what are some of the solutions? We have solutions in this book. I highly recommend that you get it, not because I wrote it, but because of the information that it has within the book itself. So now with that being done, we have two additional veterans in the studio with us today. They're going to tell you a little bit about themselves, and we want a little bit more than name, rank, and serial numbers. They'll give us that. And after that, we will get into our conversation, because today we're going to be talking about God and country. So immediately to my left is, and if you want to, you can look at the camera ahead of you, and you can talk to the people that way. And then when it's done, we can talk to one another.
Chief Petty Officer Michael Winston, U.S. Coast Guard Reserves, retired.
My name is Dr. Pride. I was in the United States Army Sergeant. I did 3 years, 7 days, and 2 hours. I'm also a Vietnam vet.
Okay, can you just tell us what years you did?
I was in from 1972 to 1995. We were the first Coast Guard unit to become a combat unit. So we did Desert Storm in 1990-91.
So what you're saying is that it's unusual for a Coast Guard to do
very much so
battles. Okay.
Very much so.
And why was that? What do you think? What was going on that became something out of the norm,
right,
for the Coast Guard to do?
What we were told was we were outside of our mission. The Coast Guard's mission was a peacekeeping mission, and we were three units in the Great Lakes, Milwaukee, Buffalo, and Cleveland. And they decided that we had no imminent attacks coming from Canada, so they knew that there was imminent problems in the Middle East. So they decided to take those three units, take them out of the Coast Guard norm, and train them as combat soldiers. And that's what they did.
So was your training, part of your training to do that, or that was in addition to the training? Now, because you sound like it, well, we weren't really supposed to do that, but
no,
we had to take on that mission.
That
to do
mission,
it.
Once they determined that they were going to go in that direction, our typical Coast Guard training was put aside. Now everything became combat oriented. So we went to Quantico Marine Base. We did everything just like the Marines and the Army did. It was no different.
So that means that there was retraining? It had to be
we
done?
We were retrained.
Because you're going from peacetime to
wartime. So they knew that there were rumors of things in the Middle East. So it was an experiment, I would imagine, with the Coast Guard because they came up with these port security units that were designed specifically for combat-related activities.
Now, you were a young man at that time, correct?
No.
Okay, you weren't.
I spent my 40th birthday in Desert Storm. Mm.
Okay.
So I was not a young man.
Okay, so then the question becomes, what, you know, you have to shift your mindset. Mm-hmm. So what was the mindset when you hear, okay, we are not peacetime anymore, we're going into wartime, so you have to make a mental adjustment. Were you ready for that? And then let me ask you this as well, when you're answering that, were you a believer in Jesus Christ at that time too?
I was a believer in Jesus Christ. I was baptized November 12th, 1962. So when I joined the Coast Guard, I did not join with the idea of going to war per se. Matter of fact, I joined the Coast Guard Reserves so that I did not have to go to Vietnam. I was not going to take a I'm not going to fight Stan because God had his own armies too. And the book of Romans tells us that we are to obey our authority, our government. So that was not an issue. But when they changed the mission, it definitely caused some eyes to be raised because I did not go in to be a combat person. I went in to be a peacekeeping force individual. So it did cause some changes in my life. It did not change my religious standings, not at all. But it did change my thought pattern as to what I'm going to do with the rest of my life. But again, I had a chance to get out because my original tour of duty was from 72 to 78. This was in 84. Mm. So I reenlisted. So I knew that it was a possibility, but it didn't change my commitment to the Constitution.
Okay, now see, there's a good question. You're talking about the Constitution versus the Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I ask you, was there some kind of mental adjustment you have to make when you have to make that kind of decision?
Right.
I'm a man of faith. Then now we were peacekeepers. Now I have to adjust my thinking to a war mentality because the I swore an oath also to the Constitution.
Right.
So how did the Constitution affect that decision-making? Because I'm only asking that because a number of people watching and listening don't know about the Constitution, or they don't know about what it means to be in the service, but also being a man of God.
Service represents the Constitution. And the Word of God, Book of Romans, says obey your government. And I joined willfully, okay? And even though they changed the mission, I was still being obedient to my government. It did not change my responsibilities. God had his armies in the beginning, just like we have here now. So that didn't have any effect on me at all, other than a personal thing. But I knew in the end, God was going to take care of me because I'm one of his own. And God will take care of his own. He's going to do that.
And we're going to come back to that because there's some people out there say, well, if God was going to take care of his own, how did I get injured? Why did I get injured? Why did I have to lose a loved one?
Everything so happens for a reason for God.
Yes,
and for God's glory. Yeah. Because we go back to the scriptures where the man asked, who sinned? Was it the man or was it his parents? As far as the blind man.
Yeah.
And Jesus said, it wasn't either one. It was for God's glory. See, so when things happen to us, we can't look at it as a punishment.
Mm-hmm.
We have to look at it as God getting his message across in a way in which it may not be best for us, but it'll be best for someone who knows us or someone who sees us. We're but a grain of sand on the beach.
Yeah.
You know, when we close our eyes in a month and a half, we're just going to be a picture on our mama's mantle. Nobody's going to remember. But that doesn't mean that we will not have had an impact on someone's life. We may not know who, but we have.
So, and I know, Brother Albert, you're over there amening that. and we want to have you elaborate somewhat on that, too, because what you were referring to, mm-hmm. those who like to read the Word of God, go to John chapter 9, which is what he's referring to, the man who was born blind.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Jesus didn't say that he wasn't a sinner.
Yeah. No.
Only thing he said is that it wasn't because of his sin or his parents' sin that he was born blind.
Right.
He said it was to the glory of God.
Right.
And we have to understand something, too. As a believer, from the believer's perspective, we understand that all things work together for good.
Mm-hmm.
All things. But to the non-believer, that sectarian, that person who does not know the Lord Jesus Christ, to them, it's like, well, why is this happening to me? I didn't do anything. So we have to look at it as well. So with that being said, Brother Albert, Brother Pride, Dr. Pride, what are your words now?
I was just listening to what my brother was saying there. For me, I was in the service from 70 to 73. I was in Vietnam from 70 to 71. Like I said, I did 3 years, 7 days, and 2 hours. And I thank God now that I've been developing a relationship with him for Vietnam. You know, I learned a lot about myself, and I learned about other peoples. And also I learned a lot about this country. You know, and the things that we consider, they consider as policing activities and stuff. When I went to Vietnam, I grew up down on 55th and Central. I went to Cleveland East Tech. Man, I was out there in the streets, man, and I was glad. I thank God because I went into the service. You know, I was drafted, and I said I took another couple of years. My brother said he was the lifer. He said, got to take more years to get a better job, which ain't true. You know, it's all about a lottery system anyway. but you know, I thank God I knew of him. I was going to church. I knew God. But I didn't have that relationship with God. But he had a relationship with me. But I didn't understand that until I went to Vietnam. And first part of my tour in Vietnam was awesome, man. I wasn't engaged in that combat activity until they deactivated my unit. Then they put me in this with the 101st Airborne, a combat unit. So we went up north to the DMZ, and the job was to support the South Vietnamese Army. But that's what I say, God had a relationship with me, because we had incoming and I didn't get hurt, you know. And it was so beautiful about God, man. You know, a lot of times we don't reach out until something happens, you know. And we was in these tents, and the shrapnel came through them tents like tearing through paper, you know. So we had this guy came along with a bulldozer and dug us a bunker. And we used to sit there, and we had a little Bible, man, and we had an artillery shell. We put sand in it and diesel, and that was our light. And we would sit up there and read scriptures. Now, we wasn't all versed in scriptures. We didn't, you know, but we read it and prayed, and, you know, and that's why I say God had that relationship with me. And so it was really hot and heavy up there. And I had 2 months left in country. And I said, Lord, I got 2 months left. I don't want to be up here and go home in a box. And God made a way. He said, the guy come in and said, who want to be a convoy guard? I said, I do. I just threw my hands up. Yeah, take me, buddy. I'm out of here. I hate to leave y'all, brothers. But they understood that I was short in country. My time was short. And it's the worst thing you can do is be short in country and get it. You know,
so you have to explain convoy.
What I mean by a convoy, it's a group of trucks strung together to protect each other. And I had what they call a 50 caliber machine gun on the top, and that was my job with the machine gun to ward off any aggression or anything like that. And when I talk about caisson, caisson was a It was a plateau surrounded by mountains. You can see the DMZ, the militarized zone from where we was at. And they was, a job was, they, what they say, is to cut the Ho Chi Minh Trail off. That's where they was bringing all the North Vietnamese, bring all the artillery and everything down the trail. But I thank God, I say God had that relationship with me, but I didn't have that close one with him. But he always took care of me. Man, because we has coming down there, and we had a mortar attack, and they was firing mortars, and man, it was the convoy, and we had the tanks on the side. They couldn't do nothing, and we blew a flat tire. And we blew the flat tire, the mortar hit right where our truck would have been. And I say, praise God, man. I was like, man, Lord, I thank you, Lord. Boy, I thank you, Lord. You know, we got the tire changed, and I didn't have to go back up there. And because my search sergeant wanted to send me back up there, but I told him, no, I ain't going back up there because I'm too short. You know, I said, if I go back, I'm going to kill you right here. He said, what? I said, yeah, I locked and loaded my M16 because, you know, I found out about military. They don't give it the right. They don't care about your life. You know, you're a soldier. They don't care about your life. You're supposed to die. But I say, ain't so, man. I am not dying in nobody's country, you know. And but that's how I say God had that relationship with me. But over time, I developed that relationship, you know, and I really developed when I got out of the service and really got into the ministry, and I got to studying God's word, you know, and applying it to my life. And one of the reasons I got out of the military too, I didn't want to reenlist because I was fed up. Because Brother Winston was talking about the Desert Storm and all that. In 1973, while I was in there from 71 to 73, we was preparing for Desert Storm. The government had started painting all the stuff desert colors, and we had desert uniforms, and they getting ready for another war. Now, this is in the 70s. Wow. You know, I say, oh, no, man, I'm out of here. I'm gone, you know. But I thank God because he had his hand on me. He watched me. The old song, Somebody Prayed for Me, had me on their mind, took the time. And then somebody was praying for me because God had his hand on me. He had that relationship. And I started developing it. And you talk about in the military, when you look at, like you're saying, as far as God and the Constitution, and we took that oath. Yeah, but I always thought that God understands. You know, I always thought he understands what we're going through, you know, and what we have to do. And so I did what I had to do, you know, because I figured, I think, God, you understand this, you know. You understand what I'm doing, what I have to do, you know. And sure, you know, I thank God that he brought me back. I thank God that he saw me through my whole military experience, because not only was I wasn't this perfect soldier, because I was into alcohol and drugs and all that stuff, man. And I was just screwed up. But God always kept his hand on me because he had a mission.
The thing that you were doing is you're being honest about that, because there's so many who were in the military. They rather hide that fact that they were going through that, or turn to drugs or turn to alcohol as the way to deal with the situation they found themselves in. You may mention the two things. You say the military did two things. It taught you something about you, and it taught you something about the country. And as you say, God's hands was on you. You had to come to that reason or rationalization about who God is through the situations you found yourself in.
That's it. I, you know, because I look back and I reflect back. A lot of times you don't really have an opportunity to reflect until later on. You know, after my head, like I said, after my head cleared up from all the alcohol and drugs and all that stuff, I can realize how God had his hand on me, how he marched me through these things, how he navigated me through this and brought me to where I am now. Right. You know, I thank him, you know, and like I said, you know, we have to realize that everything happens for a reason. Right. You know, everything happens for a reason. All I got 30, almost 40 years sobriety, you know, and I went on to school, got my math doctorate degree. I got a master's in social work. I'm a licensed independent chemical dependency counselor, you know, and all that God positioned me, all that drugs and alcohol and stuff, that God positioned me right now if I can help somebody. See, I can talk to that guy that's down in the bottom because I've been there. I can explain to him. And not only that, when I talk to him, I can show him how to get out of that. And he don't have to stay there. He can get a better job. He can get a license. He can do these things, you know. That's why I say, guys, you never know until, like, you step back and reflect. Say, oh, God, man, but it was hell when I was going through it, man. I mean, I couldn't hardly see the trees for the forest, you know what I mean? But God is awesome, you know. And one thing about the military, too, when you look at it, they didn't have, I know when I was in there, they had Catholic and Protestants. And that was it. You didn't have Catholics and Protestants. You didn't have no good old Baptist preaching here. Mm-hmm. No, you know what I mean? Church of God in Christ and none of those kind of ministers that you can go to. And a lot of times we wasn't Catholic. A lot of times we didn't go. So a lot of times we just had our own little sessions or whatever we were going to do.
So you go ahead.
I wanted to chime in just a little bit on what Dr. Pryor was saying. God knows. He told Jeremiah, I knew what I was going to do with you when you were in your mother's womb. And until you finish God's job, mm-hmm. He's not going to let anything happen to you. And I'm an artist now. I've retired from teaching and I travel around doing artwork. But I didn't start till I was 50 years old. And the thing is that God knew that if I were to start this when I was young, I wouldn't have done anybody any good because I would have been in it for the money, trying to do as best I can to make money to do this for me. But he waited till I got all of that out my system.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I got it all out my system, he laid it on me. And then when he laid it on me, I had a desire to go out. I had a desire. And it didn't bother me about making money.
Yep.
It was just doing what God gave me to do, a talent that he gave me that nobody else had. But he gave it to me. To me. I hadn't done anything that I thought, mm-hmm. but he was getting something from me. He was getting the glory.
That's
that
right.
I would have taken for myself.
That's right.
Had I done it when I was younger. And I look at it now and say, but I ain't doing nothing. I don't think it's anything. But the people that see it, they think it's something.
Yeah.
So God is still getting the glory. And as I speak to people, I never tell them what I did. I always say, God enabled me to do this. God gave everybody a talent. And I reflect on a phrase that my grandmother gave me when I was real little. She said, God don't leave nobody with nothing.
That's right.
He don't leave nobody with nothing. It took me till I was 50 years old to find out what God gave me.
Mm-hmm.
But God took me through. When we talk about the valleys and the shadows of death and all that, he took me through things, brought me out of things, because he knew that I had not achieved what he intended for me to achieve.
Yeah.
And for those listeners who are contemplating military, and God knows what he's going to do with your life. He knows. And when things happen, they don't happen by accident. God don't make mistakes. He don't make mistakes. So if you're sitting back complaining and why God did this and why God knows why he did it. You need to accept what he's done and look at what it is he is trying to do in your life and stop crying about what it was that you can't do now. Because it ain't about you.
Yeah.
No, Dr. Pryor, you want to get in again.
Like, oh, I got something else here. You know, because he's so right. You know, the thing is, you know, I do a lot of counseling. But, you know, when you're counseling somebody that don't have that relationship with our Lord and Savior, then that's where the problem comes in. why me, why this, and why that, because you don't have the scriptures to fall right. back onto that's going to encourage you to go through this, you know. And like, and they're going to go through all the little stages of grief and all that, you know, blaming God, blaming all this. But when you have that relationship, you know that's not the end. Mm-hmm. That's like Brother Winston said, that's the buyer. That's not the end. But you will see them again. So we have to be mindful of that, that people, a lot of people, like you said, circular people, they don't have that relationship. So they're dealing with their flesh and dealing with their emotions, and that causes that problem. Because I have counseled a lot of people that don't have that relationship, you know, and it's kind of difficult, you know, for them, because they can't visualize that. They can't fathom that seeing that person again. Well,
yeah, and we often find the conversation goes into religion. And yeah. People argue about the religion. Mm-hmm. And I tell them, I don't have a religion. I have a relationship. Yeah. Going back to what you're saying. When you understand the relationship that you have with the Lord and the Lord has with you, then you can apply what the scripture says, all things work together.
Yeah.
Until you know that you know the Lord. Yeah. That doesn't make a lot of sense. And that's why people argue, because they want to blame God for things, the decision that they made.
Without a doubt.
And they say, well, you know what? If God is God, how come he let this happen? Yeah. No, we're sinners and we sin.
That's it.
And because we sin, we justify those sins. Yeah. And I'm sure you did, brother. When you were drinking, you justified. You
gave yourself justification. I can justify all of it, buddy. I tell you, hey, you know, man, I had a bad day. The supervisor yelled at me about something. I'm going and get high.
I need a drink,
huh? I'm going to do this, man. I'm going to anything. I had it was so. When I used to want to go out and do my little wrong, I get up. My boy and say, "Hey, man, we're gonna be having something down. We're gonna go to the club after work." I said, "Man, I gotta get out this house, man." So I go home and start an argument. Mm. Man, this food ain't right, man. I'll leave, you know, storm out the house. Hey, man, I'm on my way. You know, when you're a sinner, you do what sinners do. You justify what you do, man. And that's what we do, you know. But when we're dealing with somebody that don't know the Lord, man, we got to be patient with them. And I always tell them it's all right to grieve, you know. And I don't try and bombard it with no scriptures, because they wouldn't understand it no way. It's just all right to grieve. You are in this stage of grief, and I'll go over the stages of grief with them, you know, but it's all right to do that, you know. And I would visit them several times after that, you know. But you got to have that relationship. Like I said, God had a relationship with me. It wasn't until my head cleared that I seen how he had everything orchestrated, everything, you know.
He took you back down that road and showed you every day. Right.
Yeah, because Brother Winston said, it ain't about the money. You know, God has positioned me to do counseling and alcohol and drug counseling, which is I'm licensed to do. And it don't have to be about, it's not about the money. Because he's taking care of me.
Yeah.
It's
about the soul.
It's about helping somebody. I had a guy, he was bugging me. I want to work with you. I want to help you. I say, you know, and the first thing out of his mouth, when I'm going to get paid, how much I'm going to get paid? And I say, well, you know, I don't really need you right now. You know, I didn't care. I just put him down softly, because to me, it ain't about the money. That's what's wrong with the alcohol and drug programs now. It's all about the money. They stretching people out. They stretching them out, and giving that money, getting that money, keep that money coming. And what happens is you have constant relapse. And the second, the most important thing, they took God out of the whole equation. You know, I got my sobriety through the church. I cried out on the floor for the Lord. Lord, take this taste out of my mouth. I'm tired, sick and tired of being broke, disgusted, and people looking at me crazy in my family. You know, like they treat me like that movie said, they treat you like an unwanted bill collector. They don't even want you out of the house, you know. That's how I was treated, you know. And my mother making all kind of excuses for why I ain't there and all this stuff, you know. You got to get sick and tired. I cried out on the floor, but at the time, now, check it out. At the time, I didn't know that I was praying and fasting. You know, because I wasn't eating, you know. Things come out by what? Prayer and fasting. And I'm praying and fasting, man. And God, I got in the church, man, and I was hungry. And I'm hungry. I want everything. I'm gobbling up. I'm sitting up. Like, it was like, wow, I'm sitting on the head of the feet, man. I'm sitting up front, right under the preacher, man. I'm absorbing everything. You know, I'm getting it. I'm getting it, you know, because I'm ready. You know, but sometimes God got to position you that. It's just like an alcoholic and drug addict, you know. Until they come to that realization, they get sick and tired. You can take them all million-dollar treatments. You can talk to them till they blue in the face. They ain't still going to go out there and do it. And just like just like God's people, till they get sick and tired to that point, then they want to sit there and listen. Not only listen, but apply it to your life. See, that's the key. There's a lot of people listening, but they don't apply it to their life.
You have to be, and everything you're saying comes down to this. You have to be broken.
That's it.
Once you get broken, God can fix you. And I don't care how many times you hear it until you're broken.
That's it, man.
Until you are spiritually broken, then and only then will you begin to listen. And as you say, you not only listen, but you're hearing what God is saying.
I'm telling you, man.
And that makes a huge difference in our lives, whether you're in the military, out of the military.
Oh, yeah.
It doesn't matter where you're at.
Oh, yeah.
But that's why I was asking about militarily speaking. With God in there with you, you had to, as you say, he was there with you, but oftentimes you didn't see him.
We didn't see him. You know, it's like the footsteps in the sand, right?
Absolutely.
That's what it was with me, man. I thought doing this all, but he was carrying me. Because I look back, when I reflect back over my life over the year, I look
See,
back and I can say,
from?
Yeah, man, God was there for me. God was there for me. When this situation, even in my drug addiction stoop, God was there for me, because I went to some places and I should have went to jail. And God said, don't go there. And I said, I'm going. Then I listened. I said, I ain't going there. And they get raided or something, you know. And God is so good, man.
But let me ask you, man, with that being said, how often did that happen to you when you, Lord said, don't do that? And you say, okay. And you say, okay, that day you skipped it.
Yeah.
But the next week, you find yourself easing down that road.
Yeah, I listen 3 times out of 10. Yeah, because I was in my addicted stoop. But when I listen, things went right, you know. I remember one time I was going to get something, and this guy was selling drugs. He never let you in the place. He always had the door half cracked, you know. And I went to the door, and his voice said, come on in, just bring your money on in, you know. And I said, whoa, Lord said, don't go in there. And I said, all right, Lord, I'm going to listen. You know, and I didn't go. And the same day, the guy went back, and I passed him on the alley. I said, hey, man, don't go down there. Oh, man, I'm going down there. We went to jail. But, you know, yeah, I say 3 out of 7 times because my mind was still messed up. You know, my mind was still messed up. But I thank God for the times that I listen. You know,
Let me ask you, too, based on the mess up, you said your mind was messed up. Was that before military or during military and after?
It was progressive. Like I say, you know, I started drinking wine. Drinking that wine, and we smoke a little weed and stuff. But one thing I can say, I can tell you about the Army. I'll tell you about when I was in there, you would get the best drugs in the world in the military. Man, I'm telling you. And it came hand and foot. The first thing they do is they drop the age where you can buy beer. You know, you can buy beer, man. That's the first thing they do. Then they have it where you don't have to pay that much for your alcohol and wine and all that stuff. So they perpetuate that. And it's like a snowball effect. It keeps going and going. That's why I say addiction is a process.
Mm-hmm.
You don't get to there overnight.
Mm-hmm.
It takes a process. Just like that process to get there, it's going to be the same process, the process going and getting down. So, you know, I don't believe in harm reduction. I believe in total abstinence. Because harm reduction, I talked to a lady, she talking about, well, we do harm reduction. I said, there's no such thing as harm reduction.
Now explain harm reduction.
What I mean by harm reduction, that means that I'm a heroin addict, and I smoke weed or I smoke marijuana or drink alcohol. Okay, so harm reduction is, I don't use heroin, I just smoke weed, smoke marijuana, and I drink alcohol. And then eventually I just drink alcohol. But I'm gonna tell you something. I've been doing this for a long time, and what happens is when your body, you take that drink, you smoke that marijuana, And your body, because what happens, you have what they call tissue dependency. Your body comes and needs it, desires it, needs it to thrive. And he's going to smoke that marijuana, drink that drink, and the body going to say, and the mind going to say, ah, that ain't what you need. You need what's going to really help you.
Right.
Let's go get that other stuff. Let's go there, because and what's going to happen? Relapse. That's why it's constant. No such that to me, my personal opinion, this is Dr. Pryde speaking. Ain't nobody else. I believe from experience that I tried that harm reduction stuff. You know, I'm going to only smoke marijuana. I ain't going to do this. I know it don't work. For me, only way is total abstinence. You have to have total abstinence. You have to have, but you got to get to that point. We talked about being broken and wanting it, you know. And like I said, the military, you know, it perpetuated a lot of that in me. You know, like I said, I grew up down there. We drink wine on the weekends, Friday and Saturday. We drank the wine and sobered up on Sunday. You know what I mean? Yeah, man, we drank it, you know, but it perpetuates it. You know, when you go in there, they put you in these hot spots, even over in the Delta, over in the Devil Storm, all that poppy fields, all that you in the center of all this stuff. Now come on, now you know there's always gonna be equal opportunities. They're gonna take advantage of that. So you know, but I thank God, man, he kept me. You know, I thank God, because like I say, I can't say it enough. You know, God is an awesome God. You know, you got to trust him, you know. And I know a lot of times I would sit down there and pray and know, like I said, I didn't have that relation, but he still answered my prayers, you know.
He knew.
Yeah. You know what? And if we need to think about it in these terms too, because my mother used to say it all the time. She said, we're here because of someone else's prayers.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
That's
none
right.
of us are here because of what we've done.
No.
It's because what others have been
That's
doing.
It.
Those others who have gone on, who have been praying for us,
That's
lifting
it.
Us up. And a good reference to that would be in the book of Job, when what Job was doing with his children.
Yeah.
He was constantly making offerings, sending offerings for them. He said, it may be that one of my children have sinned.
Yeah.
So he was constantly making offerings and sacrifices for them to the Lord. And that is the picture we should look at with our own lives. We're here by the grace of God and by the prayers of others.
It's not about you.
That's it. Exactly.
And I keep repeating that because a lot of your listeners who are wrestling with some of this stuff about the military and all of that, they're putting themselves, you know, first.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember, I can't call the scripture where Paul said, you know, for me, I don't know whether it's best to go to die now and be with the Lord or to stay
here with you.
And we have to get to that point where we know we are in this world, but we're not of this world. And what happens is a lot of us try to become like the world. And when we become like the world, the same things that satisfy the world will satisfy us. Then that's where we get that separation. But I thank God that he directed me the way he did. And I didn't have to go through everything that Dr. Pryde went through, because going in as a reservist, as I did, I was not inundated with constant military bearing. I only had it so much. And then I had regular civilian life, going to church the way I always did. And then once a month, I would have to go and get indoctrinated into this stuff. So I never had that separation from God where I had to reach out and try to find him. I knew where he was. And I had a relationship with him. And I knew then that he was going to guide me. Did I know no? No, I didn't know no. But in my heart, I knew that God was going to protect me. I could have ended up in Vietnam very easily. I was number 10 on the lottery. I knew I was gone. The lady told me I was gone. Yeah. The only thing that saved me was I was in college. That was the only thing that saved me. So many of my classmates who weren't in college, who had high lottery numbers, they ended up going. Now, did they die? I don't know. I lost contact with a lot of guys. But God knows who you are.
Mm-hmm.
He knows your manner of service. He will take care of his own.
That's it.
You may be the biggest culprit in the world, but God knows where you're going to be. See, and he's going to look at where you're going to be. He's not going to lose his service. Yeah. I hold to it that God will never put more on you than you can bear. Because if you turn away from him as a result, what has God gained? He's not going to lose a person who is a supporter of him. Because I'm putting so much on him to test him that he turns away from me. God doesn't work that way. My belief.
Well,
my belief.
Your belief is biblical, though.
My belief.
See whether we see it or not is biblical. There, what you just quoted was 1 Corinthians 10:13. Yeah. God is he's not going to permit you to be tempted
above that you're able. And I want your listeners to know that.
Yeah, exactly.
They need to know. Yeah. If they're sitting back thinking, well, God, why did God let this happen to me?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And why did God let... Who are you?
Yeah.
You know, come on. We run into this when people die.
Yeah.
And they go to a funeral and they're screaming all over the casket about why God... Look, Moses, David was of God's own heart. God took them out. Now, what makes you think you're so powerful and so good that he won't take you? It ain't about you. It's about your presentation of what God has given you to do.
It's your commitment to him.
That's what it is. And they got to stop looking at that me thing and start looking at you as the Father and the Son and the Holy Ghost.
You know, if we take the time to glorify God, he's going to take care of everything else.
He'll take care of everything else.
Don't have to worry about it. It falls on
that relationship. You know, you got to have that relationship. You know, that way with that relationship, you get an understanding, you know, and you understand, and what I mean by understanding, the cycle of life, how it works, you know, and sure, like I said earlier, we're going to grieve. That's a process. But I know I can also shout what we've been enduring for a night, but joy coming in the morning.
Exactly.
We're going to weep. But when I sit down there and think about all the good times that we had, man, you know, all the times that I can shout, man. I mean, shout at how God delivered us from things together. And I can shout. See, that's the problem is we get so caught up on the negativity, you know, of that situation, that scene, that we forget about the good times, man. Man, I went to a home going, and it was my uncle, and he was a jazz musician. And man, they had a party. You thought you were down in New Orleans somewhere. They was dancing and jamming the sax and stuff. They were celebrating going on. We as Christians, we done turned around. We don't celebrate like we should, because hey, this person is free, man. He going home to be with the Lord. You know, that's why I said a relationship. Absence from the body, present with the Lord. But you got to believe that stuff.
Right,
if you don't believe it, then you're going to still struggle with it. You know, but it's that relationship. And I thank God that I've developed that relationship and God took me down that path, you know. All that stuff I went through to get me to the point where I be able to relate to people. You know, I be able to help people. You know, and a lot of times, like one thing about the alcohol and drug field now, it used to be addicts helping addicts. Now you got these young people coming out of college, man, 23 years old, master's degrees in social work, whatever. but they don't have
no experience.
No experience, and they can't relate. And I'm trying to tell you something, and the first thing they're gonna say, dude, you don't even been through none of this stuff. But you telling me what the books say, you know, but you have to be able to relate, you know. That's why each one of us can touch somebody. Mm-hmm. I can't touch the same people you can Absolutely. Touch. I can't touch the same people. That's why God is so awesome.
And the other thing you just mentioned is very true. They have book sense.
That's it.
And see, book sense is not godly sense. Yeah. And, you know, you can quote the book to me all day and say, you know what?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. In my college, my professor said,
yeah.
And he says, so A, B, C, and D. So I know because of what they've been teaching, this works because they said A, B, C, and D. But A, B, C, and D, you may have to start with E to come back
I'm
to
telling,
A
you know,
because of the person that you're with.
I taught for 37 years in the Warrensville Heights School District. Graduate of Cleveland State University School of Education. And my sister is a second grade teacher in Warrensville Heights as well. And we both agreed that at the end of your third week of school, you had thrown out everything that they taught you in college about education, because it's different with a book versus at least with life, and especially with urban life.
Absolutely.
You find out there's a different manner of teaching that you have to do to get people to understand.
Yeah.
But the first thing you got to do is you got to take off that sin suit, expose yourself, and let God know, okay, I'm giving in. Because as long as God can't get through to you, then you're not going to get through to him.
That's right.
Yeah. He loves you, but it's like Superman. It's just like Superman. Superman, we all know, can't handle kryptonite. He can do all kinds of feats of strength, but when it comes to kryptonite, he can't touch you. He loves you, but he can't touch you. Mm-hmm. And God treats sin like kryptonite.
Yeah. Amen.
He loves you, but when it comes to caressing you and to giving you what you need, you got the sin suit on. He can't touch you. He got to stay away from you. He can love you from a distance, but he can't get close up on you. You see, you gotta take that sin suit off
and establish that relationship.
That relationship. Yeah, you, and you can't that, establish the relationship until you humble yourself. You got to humble yourself and know that you can't do it.
You know what you're saying, and we say it all the time. Until you let go, God can't do this.
That's it.
We can talk all day long. You know what? God can do this. God can do that. And yes, he can do anything.
Yeah.
But he also gave us the will
to
say yes or nay. Now, he's omnipotent.
Yeah.
And he's all powerful, all knowing. He knows what decision we're going to make before we do. But at least he's saying, I'm giving you the opportunity.
That's
why?
It.
Because he's already in eternity.
Yeah.
And he came from eternity into time to deal with us.
Yeah, with us.
Make us.
That's
but
it.
Believe it, he knows everything that's going to happen.
A bird got instincts.
Oh, yeah.
He can't praise God.
That's right.
So he can't get to heaven.
I mean, Brother Pride was saying, you know, he's out there and he's driving along. What happened? Hey, a shield, you get a flat tire, what?
Yeah.
God intervened. He said to say, well, he can't see what's about to happen,
but
I know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
So, boom, flat tire. We all out here fixing that, and the shell hits over
here.
Over
there, man.
Why? Because God is ever present.
He knows.
Now, I like what you said about kryptonite, because he's simply saying, you know, kryptonite is killing you.
Yeah.
The sin is killing you. So
killing
what are you going to do?
Yeah.
If you're willing to take off that uniform.
You got
to
do
you
it.
Say that, if you're willing to take it
you
off,
do it.
God simply says, you know what? I can make you mighty. That's what did Paul say?
Yeah.
Put on the whole armor of God. Now, he was a soldier.
Yeah.
Paul was a soldier, so he said, you know what? I believe in God. I believe in Jesus Christ. He said, but I'm out here fighting a war.
Yeah.
It was twofold.
Yeah.
It was a war against sin and a war against this sinful mentality that people have. And that's what our fight is.
Yeah.
He said, your fight is not against flesh and blood.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's against principle. It's about that mindset.
That's it.
If
that's
we can teach people that you are greater than the situation you
that's
find
it.
Yourself in, and if you, going back to what you just said a moment ago, if we humble ourselves,
that's it.
What did God simply say? I'm going to do everything I said I was going to do.
That's
now,
it.
I just have one request of you. Do the thing I ask you to do.
That's it.
Now, if he said, humble yourself.
Yeah.
If I humble myself, he said, I'll exalt you.
That's it. Mm-hmm.
But it's in whose time?
His time.
How often do we actually say, Lord, your will be done?
That's it. Yeah, yeah, because when they don't want to say that, because that comes with consequences.
Right.
Yes, it comes with consequences. Right. Well, you know, I like that because I tell you about my experience and I humbled myself before God when I was praying and fasting and I just stretched out. You know, Lord, I'm sick and tired. Just take me. I'm yours. You know, whatever it takes. You know, and I had a sister. She's an evangelist. And I had three brothers. I called my brothers up, and they said, "Nah, man, you still out there doing your thing, and you all that. No, we can't help you." All three of my brothers. So I called my sister. She said, "Pack your suitcase. Leave everything else in your apartment. Just bring your suitcase and your clothes, you know." And I said, "Wow, you know." And she picked me up. She never told me, because she was going regular, going to church. Never say, "Come on, you got to go to church with me. Come on, you got to go to church with me." Nope. I just sat there and she'd go to church. Say, "Yeah, we had a good time in church." She never browbeated me down, you know. And so one day she said, "We having a revival, pretty good speaker, you know, a young man too." I said, "Yeah, you know, I'll go." I said, "You know, I done tried everything else. I might as well try Jesus.
Why not?"
But I was there, you know. I had, like you say, I took off all that stuff, man. I was ready for the master's hand.
Gotta
you
be
know?
Ready.
And I was ready, you know, and like it's, I was ready. You know, I was ready to absorb, you know, I was ready to be a part of. I was ready to develop that relationship. You know, and I was laser focused in, you know, and God will move. You know, people say, "Well, I didn't have any money. I didn't have no job. I had lost my job. They suspended me. I was working for United Airlines and I was making like $30 an hour. But the guy told me, say, "Hey, you're a hell of a worker, but you don't come to work. You're supposed to be there at 6. You walking in here at 9 o'clock, man." You know, like, what's going on with this
thing?
You know? Yeah, you know, but I thank God, you know. One day I was walking down the street, you know, and I had been praising God, and God told me, "I'm going to give everything back that you gave to Satan." So when I see Satan, the enemy never took nothing from me. I gave it to him willingly. Cause I was in my mess, man. My money, get it. My car, take it. Take it. Wife, take it.
Now you need to say that again, cause so many people are watching, listening, say, they took everything from me. Did they take it or did you give it?
I gave it away. I gave it away. Right. My behavior, my activity, the things I do, I gave it away. He didn't take nothing. God told me, "I'm gonna give everything back to you that you gave away to Satan." I said, "Praise God, man." I used to whip my little Walkman in my ear and listen to my gospel and praying in prayer. He did. First, he gave my job back. I had a brother said, "Bro, you ain't never get that job back." Not only did God give me my job back, also he gave me some money too.
It's benefit.
Yeah, man. So I went home. My brother was sitting there. He wasn't a believer. He was this. His motto was "One with the most toys win." You know, So I told him, I said, "Bro, this is what God will do." I showed him my badge. He said, "Man, you back to work?" I said, "Yeah, I'm back to work." And not only that, this is what else God will do for you. I showed him the check, and his eyes just dropped. "Wow, man, you got that? Yeah, that's what God will do for you." See, glorifying God, man. Glorify God. See, I didn't take credit for nothing. And also, I went back to work. They made my enemies, he said, "Make enemies a footstool." Oh, he made those a footstool too. But you got to, it all starts with being submissive of God. And I took the Bible up and I said, "Lord, I believe everything in here. I'm not going to argue or nothing. I believe everything in here is your word, your word. And I'm going to stand on it." And God will do it.
God will fix what is broken.
That's it.
He's notoriously good at fixing what is broken,
man.
If we humble ourselves.
That's it.
You did something that he told Abraham, "Get thee from among your family, your friends.
Yeah.
I'm going to show you a land.
Yeah.
I'm going to take you someplace you haven't been before."
Man.
And that's what he's been doing. And until we see that we have that missing component in our relationship, we're going to have that sin suit on. That's we're going to be killed That's by it. That kryptonite. That's it's it. There and it's hurting. We're down to the last 5 minutes of the podcast.
Oh, my.
So man, this time is up. So I'm letting you guys, you have something you want to leave the viewing and listening audience with. Here's your opportunity to share something real quick.
I want to emphasize to your listening audience that it's not about you. God will do what you allow him to do. You sit back and think of all the things that you can't do anymore and you won't, but you don't think about the things that you can do. I mean, what did you do last night to guarantee waking up this morning? Mm. What did you do? What precautions did you take? What things did you say? What did you do to ensure waking up? It was the hand of God.
Amen.
Just like it touched somebody and took them away, it didn't touch you and left you for another day. You can't do it all. You can't do anything without God's help.
Amen.
God has got to do it for you. That's the bottom line to the whole thing.
Well, I only have, for short and sweet, you need to develop a relationship with God, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, and everything else will fall in place.
Sure will.
Amen. You talk about short and sweet. That was it. And I was like, okay, I just have this. And we want the viewers and the listeners to know this is, and you know what, you're saying, yeah, we struggled. We went through some mm-hmm. things. And that's the purpose of who we have been called by God to be. He's going to use our lives and our lights to generate the light for the world to see. He said, let your light so shine before men that that's they it. See your good works
that's
and
it.
Glorify the Father, which that's is in it. Heaven. That's the relationship.
That's it.
If we had a relationship, you don't have to worry about the kryptonite.
No, yep.
you don't. Amen.
Don't worry about it.
So that's all we have to do. So with that, we're going to say thank you guys for joining us this week. And we're going to have you back again quite naturally. And until next week, this is Unlocking the Power of You. I am Timothy White Sr. And we thank you guys for being with us this week.
Praise God.